Steve has recently retired from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service after an exceptional career in wildlife conservation. Since earning his doctorate from Colorado State University in ungulate nutritional ecology, Steve has worked in every aspect of wildlife conservation. He has worked as a biologist for two state wildlife agencies that include Colorado and Wyoming, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and helped lead the first reintroduction of black-footed ferrets to the wild in Shirley Basin. In 1993, Steve brought his research, agency, and management experience to bear on wildlife conservation issues in the West for the National Wildlife Federation, focusing on public and tribal land conservation. He also assisted the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia in their conservation of desert wolves and Arabian leopards. In 2011, Steve returned to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service as the Assistant Regional Director for Science Applications. Steve brought national science funding to increase understanding related to greater sage-grouse conservation, bison conservation genetics, and wolverine habitat requirements. Steve has been recognized by the Secretary of Interior, the Inter-Tribal Bison Cooperative, and state-level conservation groups for his tenacity and contributions to wildlife conservation. Steve has also been recognized by the Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies for his scientific contributions and advancement of professional wildlife management in North America. Following Steve will be Joe Barsugli. Joe is a research scientist at CSERES, which is the Cooperative Institute for Research in Environmental Sciences at the University of Colorado, Boulder, and at the Western Water Assessment, which is a joint effort between NOAA and CU Boulder. Trained in climatarian modeling, Joe's current research focuses on improving the methods used for attribution of historical trends and events, on understanding the causes of drought in the Western US, and the decline in Colorado River flows. Joe is passionate about connecting climate science with practitioners and technical staff who are informing planning for water and land management in the Colorado region and connecting researchers to problems faced by managers. Our final speaker will be John Guinotte. John is a spatial ecologist with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service in its Ecological Service Program based out of the regional office in Lakewood, Colorado. John assists Fish and Wildlife Service's field offices across Region 5 and 7 with analytical, geospatial, and statistical needs for listing or delisting species under the Endangered Species Act. Also assists in species status assessments to inform listing decisions, habitat conservation plans, recovery, critical habitat, climate vulnerability, and mitigation. He was a member of the Wolverine Species Status Assessment Core Team. John is also currently on a part-time detail with the USGS NCCASC to help facilitate and integrate climate change risk into Fish and Wildlife Services species status assessment and by extension listing decisions. And we also have Andrew Ray from NOAA's Physical Science Lab on our hosting panel today. She co-led the Wolverine and Snow Persistence study with Joe. And with that, I will ask Steve to please take it away. Thank you, Steve.
There we go. Thank you, MTS. I'm really glad to be here today and to provide this information on our recent work. Fish and Wildlife Service, of course, has the responsibility for making decisions about wildlife and plants and whether or not they should be listed under the authority of the Endangered Species Act. And wolverines in particular have been proposed and discussed to be listed under ESA for some time. And it's a very difficult animal to study. There's many folks on the line today at the seminar who can attest to that and know quite a bit about the biology of the animal. So I'll just highlight a few things. They're very, very solitary animals, very difficult to study. They are holarctic in their distribution, and they have very large territories in remote areas. So their distribution across their occupied habitat is widely spaced. There's a bit of information that's known about some of their habitat requirements and some of the high elevation areas that they use in the western U.S. In 2013, the Fish and Wildlife Service proposed to list wolverines because of the synergistic effects of climate change, especially concerns about snow cover. In 2014, that rule, that proposal was withdrawn because many factors, one of which was the uncertainty surrounding impacts of climate change. That particular withdrawal was challenged in court, and the court remanded or sent back to the Fish and Wildlife Service reconsideration of that decision, and especially stressed that climate change concerns needed to be addressed. The Fish and Wildlife Service began the process of this reevaluation, and several factors were highlighted as concerns in that reevaluation: population size and distribution, and our ability to determine occupancy of the population. The second one was, go ahead and change the slides, Joe. The second, go ahead and change them again. Sorry about that, I forgot that I wasn't changing them. The second concern was connectivity with other populations, including whether or not the wolverines in the lower 48 were becoming genetically isolated. And there is a hypothesized absolute requirement for snow for successful wolverine denning. Some work had indicated a strong correlation between snow cover at den sites and the successful denning of wolverines. And then the fourth one was really the summary of the overall impacts of climate change, especially on snow persistence. If snow cover is necessary for denning, then what's the future of snow cover look like, considering climate change? We really focused on the fourth aspect for this presentation. We did address some of the other issues, but we're really talking about number four here today. Go ahead and change the slide, Joe. Joe, there we go. There were really two foundational studies that really laid the groundwork for thinking about, can you back up, Joe? There we go. There were really two foundational studies that laid the groundwork for concerns about climate change. One was, as I said, a correlative study that described a strong relationship between female wolverine denning and snow depth around the den site. And that same those same authors also developed a description of a climate envelope that was necessary for wolverine habitat. And the second study was brought about by the Forest Service, where they took a hard look at basically west-wide in the Columbia, Missouri, and Colorado watersheds, what would be the effect on snow persistence of a changing climate. And that's a work that's referenced here by McKelvey. So we looked at these foundational studies, and we decided to try and develop a new model, a new way to assess the impacts of climate on snow persistence. And so it was important that we build upon, especially the work of McKelvey. Some of the things that were different about our model we wanted to make different was that we include precipitation, not just temperature, in the climate models. Also that we include elements of slope, aspect, and topography. We felt that it was important to look at the effects of climate change on a much finer scale, a more biologically meaningful scale. And we also wanted to estimate snow depth rather than just presence or absence. So my last slide gives you an idea of the differences in what we were striving for. The slide, the map on the left is the output of the previous study and what it predicts for snow cover in an area, in Glacier National Park. And the slide, the map on the right, is output from our new model and what it shows related to slope, aspect, topography, temperature and precipitation effects of climate. So really big emphasis for our work was trying to do this on a much smaller scale and a more biologically relevant scale. With that, Joe, I'll hand the presentation off to you.
Mute and start video, good. I'm not used to touching everything and something moved. Okay. Yes, thank you for that nice introduction, Steve. I wanted to first thank all the collaborators on this project. It's been quite a wide-ranging group. Myself, Andrea Ray, who will be part of the panel later from the NOAA Physical Sciences Lab, Ben Livna, Aaron Heldmeyer, who did the actual hydrologic and snow modeling part of this, at least for the running the model and helping with the interpretation. Candida Davis, who is now at National Snow NSIDC. She did a lot of work with the satellite stuff, which we won't talk about, but has been an integral part of this. And MTS, of course, was part of this dealing with climate projections. John Guinotte and Steve, you'll hear from, John, you'll hear from later, and Steve, of course, you just heard from. So this has been really a collaborative effort trying to get the science aligned with the biology and ecology in such a way that it provides more useful information. So we've got the snazzy title of this, where will there be snow in the wolverine denning habitat in the 2050s? And we're gonna be looking at two study areas in the Rocky Mountains. So, overview. Background, we can talk a little bit about background and objectives. I'm gonna mention a couple of the papers in more detail that Steve talked about. A little bit about methods, including looking at the study areas, looking at the actual hydrologic snow model that we use, the DHSVM model, a little bit. Talking about defining the snow environment at typical denning locations, which is a more direct approach than using the climate envelope approach, and choice of future climate scenarios. And then we'll get into the results. We're going to be showing maps of snowpack change. We're going to look at snowpack change versus elevation, and snowpack change versus topographical aspect. And John is gonna take this. We gave all this data to John, and he did a bunch of really, really great spatial analysis on it, and he's gonna show you what he came up with. And I think Steve is gonna come back before the questions and sort of wrap this up with some big questions. So this is the plan. Let me dive into it. So two papers mentioned, I was actually, really jazzed to see that when I looked at the list, at least three names I could quickly see, Audrey Magoon and Jeff Copeland and Keith Aubrey, are names that, of course, I've read their papers that were handed to me were integral to some of the previous decisions, some of the previous work on that. So state of science in 2012 is really based on, I'm going to focus on these two papers. So the climate envelope, bioclimatic envelope of the wolverine paper, and it really postulated a global correlate between wolverine habitat and snow disappearance on May 15th. So the area that has typical snow cover on May 15th was sort of an outline. The dens are shown there in these red areas, and you can see that in some areas, the May 15th snow cover, this is years with spring snow at on May 15th, so some years get it 1 year, some places get it 7 years. You'll see this metric coming back and when we do our analysis. You can see some places that sort of overestimates, really has a large envelope around there. In some areas, such as down in Montana and Wyoming, it's really kind of hard to tell whether the dens really lie within that area. we really wanted to take a more focused approach, not necessarily on entire habitat, but on den sites and what the snow environment was like. So based on Copeland's work, McKelvey took that idea of a climatic envelope and did some analyses. I'm just showing one aspect of that, where they get projections. Again, the high mountain ranges are where you actually have snow cover. You see, they have, for 2085, they had sort of three different scenarios, sort of a central scenario, an extreme scenario, and a milder scenario. And, but the numbers they came up with are things like in Montana, by 2085, snow cover area declines from basically, you know, 49% to 85%. Colorado, similar losses. But much of this loss was at lower elevation areas, not really where the known den sites are, at least. And so we really wanted to take a closer look at the denning hypothesis a little bit, or at least the denning areas. Just some mentions of methodology here. And I can't tell on your screen, are you actually seeing the whole screen, or are you actually seeing the overlay from Zoom on it?
Seeing the whole screen.
Good, and the whole slide, because on mine, I've got an overlay from Zoom that I have to sort of get rid of here because, yeah. Couple facets about this that might be, we want to come back to. Using the coarser scale, Vic hydrology model, 6 kilometer grid cells, but they're flat grid cells. They don't take into account shading and, you know, north faces of the slopes having snow persist longer than south faces and things like that. And so we really wanted to jump not just from 6 to 4 kilometers, but to a scale where you actually get that. So you'll see that when we get to 250 meter resolution. We're using a methodology called the Delta method. They use that. We are going to use that, where you just take a historical simulation and add changes in temperature and precip to that. And it's kind of a what if we replayed the last, in this case, 16 years with a warmer or a wetter or a drier climate. Our future scenarios are chosen, their future scenarios were chosen by as a range of temperature change in the Pacific Northwest. But one important factor is in the northern tier, you actually get a lot of increases in precipitation as well as temperature. So we wanted to look at precipitation and temperature change. Finally, their model proxy for May 15th snow disappearance, you know, focused on later in the spring season. So this just gives you a sense of where things were. Why is this not, there we are. For some reason, the arrows keys work sometimes. So the project objectives: to advance snow analysis, to support snow adapted species, not necessarily only the wolverine, finer spatial scales, slope and aspect, a better representation of the range of plausible future changes by looking at temperature changes and precipitation changes in the climate models. I'm not going to talk about this, but we did look at extremes, like what happens with wet years, what happens with dry years, are dry years more vulnerable, less vulnerable, things like that, to climate change. We want to build on previous methods. So a lot of the work extends the work of Kevin McKelvey et al., because it really is, those were also very large collaborations. But to depart where necessary to get to these finer scales. To focus on earlier dates than May 15th, and this was in collaboration with some of the Fish and Wildlife Service biologists that we were talking to as to when dens are actually occupied. And so we wanted to look at primarily at dates a little bit earlier, although we do look at all dates in the spring, and look at 250 meter resolutions and provide that data to Fish and Wildlife Service, really to John, to do his GIS analysis. So let's jump into this. Study areas. We picked two. As you'll see, when you do high resolution, you can't do large spatial extents. So we picked two areas. One, the left one in Glacier National Park area, where there are known den sites. The red dots show the snowtell sites that you can use for validation. There's not a lot of in situ observations up in that country. Rocky Mountain National Park area and vicinity, Never Summer Mountains, and that area was a second site. And this was picked because it's sort of at the southern climatic extreme of the northern Rockies. drier, higher up, and in the past had been talked about a potential site for reintroduction. So a little bit more in the way of snowtail sites in this area, a little bit better handle on what's happened historically. So to give you the scale, this is sort of, you know, Steve showed this upper right panel, what 250 meter grid versus a 6 kilometer grid looks like. But as a result, we could study these areas that are shown, that are outlined here, the glacier area and the Rocky Mountain area, and of course, McKelvey study based on Jeremy Littell's set of climate projections was able to look at a much broader area in the west. So you it's a trade-off. So you're gonna have to extrapolate a little bit from the work that we did if you actually want to make any conclusions about other areas. So what about the model? I'm gonna go very briefly over just some of the features, but it's a high resolution hydrology, soil, vegetation, it's got a canopy, it's got snow interception, but the snow model is what's called an energy balance snow model. So it calculates the energy and water balance in a bulk sense in the snow. So it's sort of an intermediate complexity snow model. Doesn't go all the way to talking about snowpack thermal structures, snow crystals and things like that. You can, you want to do other applications, you might want to actually, you know, look at more detailed snow models. But we are able to run it over an extensive area. And believe me, running it over something like Glacier National Park, Rocky Mountain National Park, there's only a handful of studies that have looked at this fine a scale over that large an area for any reasons. There's explicit treatment of slope and aspect and topographic shading on the snow. Talk about that in a little bit more. It models snow water equivalence. We had to actually derive snow depth from that. So using sort of typical springtime snow values. We talk about that more in the paper, some of the limitations there. So we simulated 1998 to 2013 using Ben Livna's gridded meteorological data set as inputs. We applied change factors to that baseline simulation to create 5 future scenarios. So this is the delta method. So we've got 16 years historical with actual meteorology, 16 years from 5 hypothetical future mid-century, let's call them 2055-ish, hypothetical climates based on climate models. We validated the historical runs based on snowtail for depth and MODIS for extent, MODIS satellite retrievals for spatial extent, and did a little bit of calibration of the models when that wasn't good enough. So snow depth is not explicitly modeled. We actually use bulk snow densities to get that. A big one, you know, wind and avalanche redistribution, other small scale processes are not modeled. Now we have 250 meter grid cells. So we're not modeling snow at dense sites. We're sort of modeling how much snow is around in these typical areas when we start talking about dense sites. And the meteorology at these scales is uncertain. It's inferred from the existing observational network. So keep in mind that we don't know how much snow fell at each grid, but we are inferring it from topographical controls and from nearby stations. So there are some limitations, but those are going to be faced by anybody who does this. On the right, there is just sort of shows the complexity, particularly the canopy model with snow interception and throughfall, and you know, the different wind speed profiles and the way that trees as well as slope shade the snowpack. So just to let you know that it's a sort of intermediate complexity snow model. So about denning and climate envelopes, I think we wanted to try and move beyond the simple climate envelope as we got into this project. We started looking primarily, you know, May 15th and taking our cues from the work that had done before. But then we really tried to approach it a little bit differently, to sort of describe the snow environment at or around the known dense sites, particularly in glacier, using the modeled snow depth, because we don't have observations at all these places. Especially if we don't have observations throughout the springtime at all these places. And we kind of picked some thresholds that were typical at April 15th and May 15th timeframes for how much snow is on the ground at these sites. We just looked at how much area is there in our study areas that have that much snow. We project it using the five scenarios. And then we look at comparable elevations, and we also look at topographical aspect and see how the snow, how these snow projections change into the future from the historical ones. So the question, this whole word about refugia, I can use that because I'm not a specialist, and you can jump on me for using that word, but I'm actually taking it from, in this particular application, I'm taking it from a previous work about 15 years ago that hypothesized climate refuge on north-facing slopes. So quickly, and I'm not really keeping track of the time here. Results. Well, actually, one more thing here. This is just a table of some observed end sites in glacier. And these are the modeled snow at those locations. John, you know, we gave John the grids, and he came back with what the modeled snow showed at the densite locations without us knowing where the densites were. And we ended up picking sort of a typical low end 1 meter on April 15th as a snow threshold, and half a meter on May 15th for looking at our snow availability in our further analyses. So last bit of setup, choosing climate change scenarios. This shows precipitation and temperature change for a bunch of models from the last round of the IPCC assessment, the CMIP-5 set of models that were run. MTS did this analysis. He picked a central scenario, number one, and four scenarios that kind of span this cluster of model uncertainty about the future, mid-century future. I'm going to be looking at the most extreme and least extreme change cases, the ones circled in purple. The blue dots show McKelvey's scenarios, which is interesting because they don't have much temperature difference, but they have a lot of precip difference, even though they keyed theirs off of temperature in a different region. You'll see it's very different. This is for glacier. For Rocky Mountain, we've given them names, but I'm not going to worry too much about that for now. This is details you could look at later. You look at Rocky Mountain National Park, you see the blue dots from McKelvey and Littell's work. They line up with the exact same precipitation change almost, and then different temperature change. So they didn't look at the precip differences. Our most extreme change actually has a precipitation drying, which is very consistent with the broad patterns of tending for a drier climate the further south you go in the continental United States. So we have our sets of five scenarios of which we're going to focus on two for this, for the most part for this, for the spatial analysis. You'll see all five in the rest of the graphs. So what do we get? Glacier on the left, Rocky Mountain on the right. The top one is our historical simulation, and we're looking at, just like in Copeland's work, it's a metric of the number of years that have snow depth, that have snow present, the depth of greater than 1 meter on April 15th. Number of years, we had 16 bottled years, 16 historic years, 16 future years in each of our sets. And so we can actually go through and say, well, where's the dark blue? Where is it, you know, where is it 14 of 16 years, more or less, which would be equivalent to their sort of 6 of 7 years. And you can see that in the historical period, glacier has a large area up high, of course, where that's met. In Rocky Mountain, it's not, even in the historical period, it's not quite as high. The middle set of panels is our least change, and least change by mid-century is really not that much change at all. But then you look at the greatest change, which the name of the climate model that the scenario comes from is actually is in parentheses, but I don't want to go into that details at this point. And you can see that over glacier, there's quite a large, you know, decline in the area that is 14 and 16. So that one scenario, which turns out to be very, very warm, is problematic for glacier. In Rocky Mountain National Park, our most severe scenario actually was not so bad. And this has to do with the specific climatic conditions and the high elevations in Rocky Mountain National Park area. it gets a lot of its snow in the core of the winter, which remains cold through mid-century. So that's basically what's happening there. If we look at May 15th and we can take a lower depth threshold, first of all, we see it doesn't, you know, we don't see as severe changes because we mainly because we've taken the lower depth threshold here. But you say this, see the same sense, and you can see that that one scenario, the warm scenario in Glacier really really reduces the area. The rest of the scenarios don't show such severe reduction. This just gives you a sense of the kind of grids that we sent over to John to do his analysis on as well. So analysis versus elevation. Well, on the left, we have Glacier, but we have known denside elevations, which are these triangles at the left. And so if we look in that sort of Denning elevation band, we can see the five different scenarios, percent change, percent reduction in snow covered area of this 1 meter depth. And you can see that below about 2,200 meters, there's most of the scenarios, except for that one very problematic one, don't show much change at all. As a matter of fact, you don't really have a large reduction much below, you know, the sort of this middle of this Denning band. John's gonna show calculation of what a potential Denning elevation band would look like in Rocky Mountain National Park area. And you kind of see the same story, maybe even larger area. If you put a lot of credence in this Denning elevation band, then there's a large area, the upper area that shows, you know, some declines, 10, 15% declines. And then one of the scenarios that shows a lot of decline up there. The scenarios aren't all monotonic. Sometimes a scenario will be the largest decline in one metric, but not quite the other. So, but you see the lower elevation, you can see, you know, drastic reduction, up to 100% reduction in snowpack at this time. So there's this huge elevational gradient. Let's look at May 15th, just for completeness here. And you see that, you know, but basically what you're seeing is that the sort of elevation band at which you're seeing a lot of snow reduction sits higher the later in the spring you get. So this sort of explains a lot of the, you know, sort of, these results aren't really contradictory to what happened earlier. I mean, it's just, there's a question of really when you're looking at in the season and what you're looking at as to how you interpret this. So I don't want to go too much detail about this because of time, but looking at the north versus south facing slopes, why is this an interesting problem? Because we know like south facing slopes melt out sooner than north facing slopes in general. But solar radiation dominates south facing slopes, but how these things change in the future is much more complex. North facing slopes, solar radiation is a much smaller factor in the energy budget. So how the other terms, long wave, sensible latent heat fluxes and such, how they change on north-facing slopes, as well as the fact that you have different vegetation and different, you know, different roughness, wind roughness and turbulent fluxes. It's all very complicated. This little gem of a paper by Jessica Lundquist, Lundquist and Flint in 2006, Journal of Hydrometeorology, you know, it really gives some nice theoretical understanding of this. But they basically say it's really complex. We're going to need distributed models. But they also hypothesize that in places like Colorado in particular, these basins may provide refuges for plants, and which is what they were looking at, against climate change that could be targeted by resource managers. So is their hypothesis borne out by our detailed modeling? This is the analysis that Aaron did. This shows percent reduction as a function of the aspect north, northeast, east, southeast, south, southwest, west, and northwest facing slopes. Zero line at the top would be the historical run, and these are just the five scenarios sort of lined up. And what you see is that particularly, you know, south, southwest, southeast facing slopes, just like to some extent west facing slopes get hit pretty hard. North and east facing slopes don't. And this is a bunch of, you know, north-facing slopes, we understand. East-facing slopes, a lot of that has to do with specifics of the topography in these areas. But that's the general character. If we look at what happens this is just snow water equivalent, so there's no depth involved in this calculation here. And you see, you know, greater reductions as we go later, May 15th, but we still see this fairly large difference between south-facing and north-facing slopes. This is, to my knowledge, the first time that really has been looked at in detail. There's been a couple of other papers that have looked at this under climate change. So there's really not a lot, surprisingly little work on that.
Joe, I just wanted to do a time check.
Yeah, the time check is, the key points are this is a more complex and nuanced picture than McKelvey's paper presented. Early spring snowpack declines in the lower half, but not so much in the upper half. Increased precip can buffer the effect of temperature increases in many of these climate change, particularly at the highest elevations early in the season. Farther north, of course, there's more precipitation increase, but in Rocky Mountain, it also works because a lot of the snow falls in the cold season. Northeast facing slopes we talked about. And, you know, more controversially, it does support viability of continued conservation efforts through mid-century. Now, these are mid-century, not end-of-century projections. And perhaps, you know, it doesn't rule out the potential for reintroduction just because of snow. So with that, that's one quick point. The data is available when you go to the paper that just came out. And all the data sets here from March 1st to June 1st. So if you want to look at different time periods, you know, have at it. And an earlier report contains more details and more analyses, particularly the historical variations. So I'm going to leave it at that.
Hey, Joe, I'm just going to mention the supporting information with the papers. Journals usually require a certain number of word limit, but there's a lot of great stuff in the supporting information.
Yes, and don't miss the supporting information. It's good.
And you can link to it from the journal when you go on to Earth's Future. If you look at the journal, it is the supporting information for the journal article. So it's linked from there as well.
It's actually linked from this link on the presentation. So if you're going to pick the presentations out too, that would be good. Okay, just let John do his thing. So I'm going to drive to stop share here.
Yeah, thanks, Joe. Let me see if I can share this. Oh, wait, sorry. Okay, can everyone see?
We can see a slide and you can take them in the presentation. Yes, we can see the presentation.
Okay, great. Well, thanks, Joe. So I'm John Guinotte with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. I just want to take a quick second to thank several of you who are on the Zoom call for providing information to the service that really helped us out immensely in terms of some of the spatial analysis that we did, particularly those of you that provided densite locations. So I'm really going to talk about kind of how we combined the future snow model results that Joe just spoke about with information that we had on historical densites, which came from several of you on the line in the lower 48, to try to narrow down really areas that wolverines have used to den in the past and that are also projected to have snow in the future based on those projections that Joe just went over. So I Joe didn't show this slide. I thought he was going to, but this is basically a regression of densite locations with elevation and latitude. And so I'm going to show you, and you can kind of see a map of the densite locations. We had roughly almost 50 densite locations across the lower 48 to go off of. The glacier densites, can you see my cursor? Does that show up when I hover over glacier?
Yes, it does.
So that's these, this cluster of densite locations here. You can see it roughly between 48 and 49 degrees north latitude. And as you can see, the lower in latitude that you go, the higher in elevation the densites are. So these three on this end of the line are the ones in California. So I'm just gonna go to the next slide here real quick. I'm gonna show you some of this for glacier to begin with. Joe showed this slide. Historical densites show us that the denning elevation band in glacier is roughly 1,500 to 2,300 meters. but the majority of which were between 1800 and, you know, roughly 2200-ish, 2300 meters. I'm going to show you results, some maps here in just a second, that just for two of the scenarios that Joe highlighted as well, that was kind of the largest decline scenario, which was Myrock. It's this yellow line. That was the extreme scenario that Joe showed earlier. And then kind of the least decline scenario, which is the purple line, which is the GISS scenario. I'm just quickly going to touch on this slope issue. I found this to be really interesting, but this slide shows locations of some of the historical dune sites in Glacier. This is a zoomed in version in Glacier. And you'll notice there are, you know, they're denning in areas of high topographic relief, but not specifically on the steeper slopes within those geographies. And it's kind of interesting if you look at these green dots, you know, it's areas of high topography, but not necessarily in very high slope areas. So the red is showing, you know, slopes greater than 25 degrees. But actually, you know, we did an analysis of, you know, for all 47 dune sites in the US and found that the vast majority, I think it was either 96 or 97% of those dune sites were in areas with slopes less than 25 degrees. And we also spoke to several avalanche experts, and they communicated to us that the risk of avalanche increases substantially in areas with slopes greater than 25 degrees. So anyway, I want to show you this slide, which was, you know, we combined, so this is also Glacier. We combined the information on slope and elevation denning bands with the future snow model results to come up with these maps. And what you see here is, you know, this is the Myrock scenario, which is showing the largest decline for May 1st across the study period. But I guess the take home point is really the dark blue are areas that meet all criteria. So it's within the denning, the historic denning elevation band. There are areas that are less than 25 degrees in slope, and they're also projected to have, you know, significant amount of snow cover at May 1 in the future, at least until 2055. And you can see in the legend, there's some aerial estimates of kind of the total square kilometers of area that we expect to meet that criteria under this scenario. So in this case, all criteria are met. There's, you know, almost 500 square kilometers of area within the domain in Glacier that meet all of those criteria. And they're also, as you can see, fairly well distributed across the total domain, which I think is an important point when you consider the large territories that wolverines need. And so the light blue is future snow, but mostly higher elevation and slopes that are greater than 25 degrees in slope. And so that's, you know, that's an additional 803 square kilometers in the light blue. And then the gray is areas that kind of meet the slope criteria in the elevation band, but are not projected to have snow in the future under this scenario. So this slide shows you kind of the least decline scenario, which was the GISS scenario. It's really the same story as the last slide, but you'll notice that the total square kilometer areas of coverage have gone up. So the dark blue in this case under a, you know, least decline scenario is about 1,024 square kilometers in the dark blue, and then an additional 1,262 square kilometers in the light blue. Again, fairly well distributed throughout the domain. And as I said, is a pretty important consideration considering the large home range size of wolverines in general. So this slide basically shows the locations of the dens relative to projected snow. And I think these are from Jeff Copeland, I believe. But basically we wanted to look at, you know, well, if snow declines in the future, you know, how far are the historical dens from projected snow in the future? And so we ran a distance analysis to show, you know, basically how far would wolverines have to travel in the future to find snow for denning, you know, based on these historical locations. And this table here shows this. And I might mention, I meant to mention this earlier, but all of this stuff that I'm showing right now is in the species status assessment, which is publicly available now. If you don't have the link, we can get that to you. But you can see that I've just run this for three different scenarios: the MIROC, which was the greatest decline, the CNRM, which was kind of a moderate decline scenario, and then the GISS, which is the least amount of decline. For 14, we had 14 den sites in Glacier to do this on, but the zeros basically mean that wolverines wouldn't have to travel at all, that, you know, the historic denning locations fall in pixels that are projected to have snow cover in the future under, you know, under those scenarios. And I've kind of flagged this den site 14 because in the red, because it shows the greatest distance a wolverine would have to travel, you know, according to these scenarios anyway, is about 574 meters to the nearest pixel that's positive for future snow. So again, this is the regression. We've got, I'm gonna show you some results from Rocky Mountain National Park. We don't, you know, it's currently not occupied by reproducing wolverines that we know of. And so we inferred the elevation band of denning, which is roughly 2,700 to 3,600 meters from this regression analysis. And let me show you. And so Joe showed this earlier, but this shows you the results, you know, for the largest decline, which is the HAD-GEM2, which is the orange line. And then the least decline is the GISS, this purple line. So I'm gonna show you a similar map for those two scenarios next.
John, a quick time check.
Okay, I'm almost finished. So similar legend as before, all the criteria covered is about 339 square kilometers, pretty well distributed throughout the domain, and an additional 446 kilometer at higher elevation and steeper slopes. Under kind of the least decline scenario, all criteria met is about 493 square kilometers and an additional 538 at higher elevation. And then I just have a couple more slides here, MTAS. So this is kind of the back of an envelope stab at looking at potentially how many wolverines could be reintroduced into Rocky Mountain, if that's where things were headed. The blue circles are approximate female home range size. There's quite a bit of variability in home range size, as most everyone on this call knows. But it's also, we superimpose some of Bob Inman's modeled maternal habitat, which is that hatched polygons. And, you know, so the idea here would be, you know, could you combine the future snow model results with these data sets to identify areas where wolverines could be released as part of a reintroduction program? And, you know, again, this is really rough estimates, but, you know, potentially you may be able to get five females into this domain and maybe one to two males. But again, that's a really preliminary type of analysis, but I think it does show how it could be used for an effort like that. And this is my last slide. I just wanted to mention that, you know, I think the technique is pretty solid in terms of the future snow projection. And I think we're talking about, you know, how can we expand the modeling domain across the Rockies. And Ben Lebna, who I don't know if he joined the call or not at CU, has a proposal submitted to the North Central CASC to extend this snow modeling project to 10 to 12 more sites in the Rockies and potentially even the Cascades if funding, you know, that's obviously funding dependent. But from a service perspective, I think this would help us, you know, for several other alpine species on species status assessments, in addition to wolverine conservation work. And one caveat I would say is that, you know, we're only looking at snow persistence here, and it really doesn't get at the potential indirect impacts of snow. which are likely to be, you know, important to wolverines and other alpine species. So I just wanted to make sure we mentioned that. And that's all I have, NTS.
And is Steve going to make the final comment?
Yeah. Can you hear me? Okay. The screen changed.
Yes, we can. Hello. Go ahead.
Okay. So thanks, everybody, for your time, and to Joe and John for going into detail on the study. I think there's some important information here, and potentially good information for positive information for wolverine conservation. I think it's important to note that we designed this study with the underlying premise that snow was a mandatory habitat requirement for successful denning by wolverines. There's still no definitive demographic performance information about wolverine denning and snow, but there have been subsequent publications about wolverines using other kinds of denning habitat. So I think the important thing is here, with at least the time frame that we looked at, we have some time to expand, hopefully, the population size and distribution of wolverines. It's not, as far as climate change is concerned and snow persistent at den sites, that probably is not going to be a limiting factor given what we know. As John said in that last slide, there's a lot we don't know about vegetation responses and prey and scavenging ability, but this tool is potentially available now for others to use in other locations, not just for wolverine, but potentially for other alpine critters like ptarmigan and other kinds of animals that need snow at different times during their life cycle. So with that, MTS, I think I'll turn it back to you and see if there's any questions.
Yes, thank you, Steve, Joe, and John. It's a great presentation. We have just a little bit of time for questions. I'll allow folks to ask questions themselves. They'll be able to unmute themselves. But we have three questions submitted on the chat box, and I'll start with the first one here. Is competition for other species a factor on wolverine success?
Well, I guess I'll take that, MTS. This is Steve. There's documentation of concerns and issues with that. That's not really what we're talking about here today, though. But this is focused on the climate and the, you know, predicted changes in climate and denning habitat. That's what we're focused on today.
Great. I think the other question related to recent wildfire activity is any speculation on the effects of recent wildfire in Rocky Mountain National Park on potential wolverine habitat?
Well, I guess I'll take that one too, MTS. Again, it's not really what we're talking about. The best, you know, the non-snow model, the best non-snow model we have is Bob Inman's model on maternal habitat. As a matter of fact, we just had another paper come out about, early in 2020, about our ability to find wolverines and look at their occupancy of habitat. And we were very successful in putting up camera traps in areas predicted where there would be wolverines by Bob Inman's habitat model. So I guess you'd have to take a look at running that model in the areas in the park. Most of the area in the park that was burned is pretty small compared to the areas outside, but you'd have to run Bob's model to see what those effects might be.
And this is Joe. I wanted to emphasize the fact that we are using a static vegetation map for this, for these projections. And of course, you know, it's very, very difficult to project at these scales what's going to happen to vegetation. And fire, of course, is one of the big agents of change for vegetation in these areas. So yeah, I think the next threshold, at least on the climate part of this, should be trying to consider a little bit more holistically the kind of changes you're going to be seeing. And that's very true as you get out towards the end of the century, where you do expect under some of these scenarios to see fairly large vegetation shifts. And also, particularly if you get into like Greater Yellowstone, there have been some projections of quite a lot of, since it's sort of a plateau, that it kind of all goes at once. And those things really do need to be gamed out if you're really looking, particularly beyond the 2050s.
Thanks, Joe. Again, I guess next question probably for Steve and John. Would there be a potential genetic bottleneck if wolverines were introduced to Rocky Mountain National Park?
That would be one of the factors you'd have to consider.
The next question is whether models run to 2100 or just 35 years out. Joe?
So we're considering this sort of delta change method, looking at a typical climate in really 2040 to 2070. So no, we did not look at 2100, largely just because of analytic capacity based on the, it was a relatively small small project as far as funding goes. It would certainly be something that would be worth looking at. We also were working with Fish and Wildlife Service and was concerned about this, these sort of more midterm questions. So we chose to focus on mid-century. One interesting thing, if you want to get some sense let me see if I can go through to the very end here. I have a slide at the end. If you go back and look at our overlay on the work of on the Littell and McKelvey work, the purple areas is their most extreme scenario, where snow still persists in the end of century. Now, you can see that in the highest mountains, snow still persists on May 15th in these areas. So you could get some sense of, you know, the last stragglers of the snowpack, even under the most extreme, their most extreme scenario. So it's not out of the question, but things certainly do get more problematic as you get to the later century, as the elevations where the snowpack decline is large just sort of rises up, you know, starts chipping away at the habitat. It does for really all mountain species. Mountains are great in that you don't have to go far to recover your old climate. You have to go up until that up no longer exists. So that's a classic sort of framing of mountain climate change and ecology.
Great point, Joe. I think you get the last word here. Yeah. We are just
well,
on top
I mean,
of the-
I was a if that's the last word, then I'll let you have the last word.
Just we're at the top of the hour, and I'll just want to thank all our speakers once again for this excellent presentation. And this is our last webinar for this year, and we hope to start back in January. So look forward to our emails and look forward to seeing you soon. Let's take care.